Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us.
We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sin is forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you have placed within the hearts of all your children a longing for your word and a hunger for your truth. Grant that we may know your Son to be the true bread of heaven and share this bread with all the world through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Welcome to Augsburg, and we give thanks for your presence here today in this 10th Sunday of the season after Pentecost. And if you're visiting with us, a special welcome to you, and please let us know how we can join you in your faith journey. As we gather today, we're thankful to two substitutes who are familiar to our community for leading us in our music today, for Adina, who is back on the organ bench. She was an organ intern last year and playing today, and for Dr. Armitage, a familiar face conducting the choir, as Dr. Olson is on family vacation this week. So thank you to both of you and to the choir, who every week sustains us in our worship as we give thanks for God and the gift of music. A lot happening as we ready for a new school year, mindful that the Winston-Salem Forsyth County Schools has started the school year earlier this year, and we operate a lot of things based on that. So that keep an eye on things like Blessing of the Backpacks and other ministries that will start earlier. But in these last weeks of summer, Pub Theology returns this Thursday evening. We'll have our last block party with the dwelling this week, and Pastor Katie does need a few volunteers. She's here in the back today if you're willing to help her with that. And a number of other ways that we are just moving through the summer, getting ready for a busy school year and fall. A lot of that is construction related, and we'll keep you posted on updates. We've had a great report this week from our construction team, and things on the first floor in the Family Life Center and future youth area are going very well. But one element of that that will impact you is that your key fobs will need to be updated, and we thought that that would happen this week, but that's been pushed back to August 12th. We hope that for most of you, it's just a simple something we do on the computer, and yours will continue to work. But do be mindful that we may need to draw you to the office or to give you a replacement. I just wanted to let you know, as we told you that would happen this week, it's now August 12th when that's going to take place. We'll certainly keep you updated both in announcements and through our online communication. Our service continues now as we hear God's word.
A reading from 2 Kings. A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing food from the first fruits to Elisha, the man of God, 20 loaves of barley and fresh ears of grain in his sack. Elisha said, "Give it to the people and let them eat." But his servant said, "How can I set this before 100 people?" So he repeated, "Give it to the people and let them eat, for thus says the Lord, they shall eat and have some left." He set it before them, they ate, and had some left according to the word of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
A reading from Ephesians. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. I pray that, according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, and so also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." When Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening had come, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing, and when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I, do not be afraid." Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land toward which they were going. The Gospel of the Lord. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. You look hungry.
Don't worry.
I brought lunch. So I grabbed a almost full loaf of honey wheat bread off the counter. And then I found out there in our crisis control food bucket, tin of chunk light tuna and chicken of the sea, which is definitely not chicken. Now, by my understanding, this should be enough for all of us to eat. were about 1/50th of what Jesus fed that day. So we've got this covered. Can you imagine how Philip must have felt when Jesus was testing him? And it was roughly this much food, a little more, to feed 5,000 people who had followed them out of the villages, who had seen what Jesus had done, how he was able to cure the sick, and wanted to be near him, and just kept following and following him away from all these sources of food, away from anywhere where they might be able to be nourished. And Jesus says, oh, now we have to feed them. How are we going to do that? Can you imagine how Philip must have felt when Andrew said, well, gee, this kid has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. Almost as if that was mocking the situation even more. How did it feel when I presented to you this much food with an expectation that all 100 plus of us gathered here in this room now would be satisfied? It seems silly, right? But perhaps what's silly about this is that we're thinking about this from human terms. And the gift of this story, which in this gospel context is the feeding of 5,000, but this is the only miracle that appears in all 4 gospels with different head counts and different stories depending on the writer. But here in this moment, they all have the same ilk, the same understanding, the same direction that God calls us to follow in hearing this mighty miracle. Here the disciples look and see that they have little. Here they're in fear because they do not know how they're going to feed these overwhelming crowds which are following them, great in number. Here they have just this 5 barley loaves and 2 fish which this little boy has brought with him on this journey. And yet there's this clear expectation that everyone will be fed. The disciples are limited by their context and by their understanding and by their able to process just how much they had in front of them. But they have not yet figured out what Jesus is able to do. And what happens in this blessing of the bread and of the fish is that it becomes so abundant and so available for everyone to eat that it wasn't as just if the Gospel of John said and everyone had enough to be sustained. No, they had so much that they could go for seconds and thirds until they were satisfied. And even when that was the case, they gathered up enough segments of bread left over that it filled 12 baskets. What Jesus does in this miracle is allows the people of God, both those who've been following him in the call of 12, and all those who are longing to know him better, an understanding of what God has sent Jesus into the world to do. And that is change our perspective and understanding of the limitations that we have in our lives certainly don't belong to God. For in Jesus, we are freed from those limitations. And in Jesus, we are able to be miraculous people who are able to go out and do great things, not limited to what we brought, but what God brings together. Not limited to what we brought, but what God brings together. And time again, we see glimpses of those miracles in our community and in our daily lives and the work that we do as church, and we understand exactly what this text is all about. When we limit it to what might be in our possessions, in our bank account, in our perspective, we are only limited by what we think we can do. But we're invited to draw into community and share in an abundance that comes from God. God can do even more. Today, as every fourth Sunday, is a fishy fourth Sunday. And you know how much I love alliteration, and so fishy fourth just rolls off my tongue with the pastoral prerogative of witty words that I love to simply share. That's fun. And there in that moment, I want to tell you how God's abundance made known in the simple cans of tuna and not chicken of the sea that you bring each week has a tremendous impact on what God is doing in the miraculous ways that Jesus works. You see, about 50 years ago, all of the downtown churches, us and St. Paul's and Centenary, First on Fifth, Home Moravian, Calvary, St. Philip's and others, they were all getting the same phone calls every day. I'm hungry. My kids are hungry. Do you have any support? And they all realized that in their limited capacities that they didn't have the abilities or the people available to go and to feed neighbors in need. So about 50 years ago, Crisis Control Ministries was formed to address that purposes and others. And as many of you know, that's one of my favorite ministries here in town that we support as a congregation and that I support in my own time. But in an understanding of that, drawing all of that together, taking the five loaves and two fish that we can offer, and that St. Paul's can offer, and that home can offer, and when that's all brought together with gifts of congregations and gifts of individuals, Crisis Control can do some amazing things. Not only do they provide food pantry support, but they also have a well-stocked and certified pharmacy for those with medical needs. They also have a whole lot of services that help with government intervention or interaction when people need help with their utilities or other services, and counseling programs available for financial counseling to help people get back on their feet. And we know that when people come in crisis, their needs will be met. For us to simply try to do that alone for a whole community, as one pastor, as one congregation, would be too much. We'd feel like Philip and Andrew, overwhelmed. But when God drew all that together in shared work, it was a recognition of the great things that could happen when Jesus takes shape and when miracles happen every day. So then, after years of doing this, and after this growing of a food pantry and a critical need from the community, it was discovered that oftentimes they'd end up with a lot of one thing and not enough of another. So I would have loved to be at this meeting that happened long before I was pastor here. Social ministry chairs and outreach folks and pastors from congregations all got together and they all picked a staple. And they all decided on one staple that they would help contribute each month so that the food pantry would be able to serve to its fullness. I know that Home Moravian is rice and Calvary's the beans, and we ended up with something fishy. And our commitment over the years has been to provide canned tuna and canned salmon and other products from that aisle of the store for the proteins that it provides for so many people. And that's why over the years we've had fishy fourth Sundays like today and every month. And you can certainly bring them in the weeks in between and put them in the buckets. But it's an idea of how when we do our little part, our five loaves and two fish, and join with other congregations well beyond the ones that I mentioned that were starting that years ago, and when we all bring something to the table, then God can do great things. It's no different than what we do in our partnership with Christ's Beloved Community, where we've planned breakfast foods, recognizing that other congregations and groups provide other food pantry support, and certainly the federal government provides a lot of assistance through Second Harvest Food Bank, but what doesn't come along with that assistance is breakfast. And we all know that breakfast is the most important meal of the day. And every time we park a U-Haul and back and we take the food that you've already dropped off and you bring that afternoon and we fill it and send it down there, we know that for that next 2 weeks or next month or however long it is, that people will once again be fed and nourished just as they were on the mountainside that day. But it doesn't stop there. Because one thing that I've recognized is that when God calls you to a place of abundance, God calls you to continue that abundance in every aspect of your life. We are given a choice as people, as congregations, as communities, as a nation. We are given a choice to operate in one of two mindsets. First, we can survive in a culture of scarcity, or we can thrive in a culture of abundance. We can operate within a culture of scarcity, or we can thrive within a culture of abundance. And when in our broken selves we choose scarcity as individuals, as congregations, as wider bodies, and we hold on to what is ours, we hoard that for ourselves, thinking we're going to need it for another rainy, hungry day, when we're unwilling to share what we have with others, then that's about as far as you can get with a hope of crossing our fingers that we have enough to make it through each day. But when we continue to trust that God is at work in what draws us together whether it's bringing in different staples to a food pantry or sharing resources at the dwelling or all of the different things that we do, when God draws us together in a culture of abundance, we are able to thrive. And so that's why your social ministry team and your stewardship team and your congregational leadership and pastors don't hesitate to keep asking, to keep inviting, to keep motivating you to be part of that abundance. And yes, it's a lot. Yes, it's a lot to ask for the fishy fourth and for the breakfast foods and for the school supplies for Lutheran World Federation, which are out there on the Narthex lobby, which I just remembered I forgot to include in the announcements. And all the other things that we do, right? We ask and we ask, we invite, knowing that as you are able and in your place, that you are able to share as God has called you. But we don't stop there, because we ask and invite people to participate in the life of providing their time and their treasures and resources to keep this church going year after year after year. And then you're invited beyond that to make big changes in campus renewal and all the things that we will do so that this congregation can be vibrant and versatile to respond to the needs of God's people and our community for generations to come. We ask and we trust and we thrive in this culture of abundance, even when we sometimes feel like Philip and Andrew and only see the barley and the fish before us. But that's what Jesus does in this text. He takes two amazing miracles and reminds his disciples that the limitations that they can think with are far exceeded by what Jesus can do. When the disciples are worried, how will we feed all these people? Jesus shows up. And when the disciples are in fear that Jesus isn't with them on a rocky sea, Jesus walks on water and shows up. And when we need Jesus in our lives in those times where we are scared, in those times where our health concerns are getting the best of us, in the times where things seem overwhelming, or depression, or loneliness, or bitterness, or uncertainty about the world around us and the political climate that we live in get the best of us, we know that Jesus is with us. Jesus would never leave us. Jesus found the disciples on a rocky sea, and Jesus finds us in the waves of our lives. We can choose to respond to that by holding on to that little bit of Jesus in that moment and pray to survive in a culture of scarcity, or we can trust that what God does when we bring our little pieces together end up being a whole lot more and thrive in a culture of abundance. So that all who hunger gather gladly and gather to be reminded again and again of what Jesus is doing. For these miracles that Jesus did were not limited to the Gospel of John or the other Gospel writers as things that simply happened 2,000 years ago. No, you are invited to participate in that miracle every week when you come to the table. For in something as small as a wafer of bread and as a sip of wine, you are invited to be part of that abundance of God's love, of the feast that has no end, of a communion of saints of thousands and thousands of years, of billions of people who all share in that miraculous promise that we are never alone with Christ Jesus, our Lord. And so when you come, no matter what Andrew or Philip or uncertainty you have about the world, and you come and receive that bread, and you dip it in that wine, and when you know in the real presence that the body of Christ is with you, that that blood of Christ was shed for you, then there is an abundant miracle beyond all measure, even in the smallest of forms. God is present, and God's abundance is never ending. I am confident that bins will continue to be filled, that U-Hauls to CBC will never go empty, and that the people of God now and those we've yet to meet will gather here and in other settings to continue to do God's work and gather gladly and gather in abundance. Thanks be to God. Amen.
confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
Creator of heaven and earth.
God of generations, you work in us far more than we can ask or imagine. Bless the church you have called into being across time and space and fill it with the power of the Spirit for loving service. Lord, in your mercy. God of field and forest, streams and seas, you are the fullness of all things. As grains of wheat grow upon the earth and fish swim in the waters, sustain your creation. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear me, our prayer.
God, beyond borders, you rule all in all. Bless the work of humanitarians and peacekeepers. Shield those who live, work, or serve in harm's way, and bring an end to war and conflict. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear me, our prayer.
God of healing, you open wide your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. We remember any who are sick or suffering, families in our community who endure hunger, those who seek asylum, and our beloved for whom death is near. Today we lift up Kathy Leiner, Debbie Baker, Michael Taylor, Barb McCusick, Elizabeth Robinson, Sandy Nicastro, Lynn Tart, Sarah Nell Hope, Ron Key, Gail Armour, Art Kynes, Marie Merritt, Robbie Fox, Oscar Thomason, Harriet Cunningham, Kathy McAlee, Gail Nichols, Sue Holland, Christopher Lilladola, Nelda Clayton, Judy Vernon, Martha Clark, Elaine Williams, and all those we lift up on our lips and in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. God of grace, you root us and ground us in love. As you inspired our ancestors in this place, sustain us also in our new endeavors, that your glory may be made known and your loving kindness shared anew. Lord, in your mercy. God of all, your love in Christ surpasses all knowledge. We give thanks for the departed who have come to know the fullness of your grace. Join our voices with theirs and all the saints in singing your praises. Today we remember Bobby Reichert, Philip Maxwell, Johannes Woldemarium, Marcus Hester, Shirley Yunt, Peggy King, Jim Robinson, and Stephen Griffin. Lord, in your mercy. Holy God, holy and merciful, into your outstretched arms we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in the one who is the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also
we share God.
Thank you.
and merciful God. You are most holy and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son so that everyone who believes may not perish but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering, therefore, his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these gifts of your own bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin may be formed to live as your holy people and be given our inheritance with all your saints. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
You are welcome to God's table, where there is always more than we could ever expect or imagine.
Thank you.
the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace.
Power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The God of all grace bless you now and forever.
Amen.